I have started recording. I'm staring into my camera and I say, Ham Radio Now episode, I think this is 132. Don't hold me to that. Look down here and you'll see, see what it is.
Episodes.
Oops, Jeff's on my Skype line here. Yeah, we've added up quite a few. So this episode is my stupid plan for 60 meters. So
we already have 60 meters.
we have 60 meters, but we're going to potentially get more. And I've got a stupid plan for the way I'd like to see it put together.
I'm looking forward to hearing it.
Yeah, we'll talk about that in just a moment. But as usual, I've got a couple things I need to interrupt with. And the first one is a surprise treat for you, and that would be this. Can you see that?
Yes, I can. It's Best Pro Shop.
Yeah, yeah.
And Harrison Avenue near Interstate 40.
Yeah, now the folks in the audience, they don't care about this at all. But you do.
Yes.
Because you'll be a customer. And the nearest Bass Pro Shop to us has been down by Charlotte.
Yeah.
Right?
About 130 miles.
Yeah.
130.
Good round trip. How often do you go down there?
A couple times a year, maybe. But, you know, there's other sporting goods stores. So that trip, we combine with, we have a son that's 20 miles from there. So
he's a ham, isn't he?
He is, yeah. KE4CTW.
But although we need to revoke his license because he's never using it.
Right.
So, Eric, if you're watching this,
he's not watching it.
No chance of that. So anyway, this is just down the road from me and a little bit farther from you, but it's very close by and it is almost open. They've got an event coming up in a couple of days where I don't know if that's going to be the grand opening, but it's coming. So
yeah, I'm very excited about it.
Yep. So, let's see, what else have we got? The review that I wrote on the Oshing radio that I've talked about a little bit, that is scheduled for the April QST. I think I've got a little picture of that here. That's the review, the rough review that that the folks at QST sent me for me to just check out and make sure that everything is okay. And it all looked good. So it is slated for the April issue, but I have bad news. Well, they whacked a lot of stuff out of it. They did a very good job of editing my really way too long copy down into something that they could fit into the magazine. And okay. it's pretty good. I've got a lot of space in this one for a review of a so-called dual band radio.
Do they not tell you how much space you get when you're doing a review?
The editor has suggested that perhaps it's time we start doing that because I always send them something too long. And in fact, this time I sent them something too long and then I sent it something shorter and they still had to shorten it up quite a bit from that.
Okay.
The bad news is Wiffle Trees didn't make the cut.
I can't. I'm too old to remember what the review said, but I don't remember Wiffle Trees.
Wiffle Trees didn't. Let me show you what Wiffle Trees are. I've got to grab this little camera here, and try to get it pointed over at the radio. This is going to get bouncy for a moment. Okay, so that's the Oshing radio. I'm a long way from my microphone. Here are Wiffle Trees. See those there? Those lines.
Oh, yeah.
Those are Wiffle Trees. And you might say, well, that doesn't help you at all. Still don't know what Wiffle Trees are.
Looks like a band scope of some sort.
Nah, it's just four horizontal lines. Eight horizontal lines.
Okay.
Yep. And what that is manual writer's flight of whimsy. In terms of describing something in the radio, what happens is you push a button and on any radio, you push a button when you're going to enter a frequency and something happens in the display. It either blanks out or whatever, waiting for you to start putting in digits.
Right.
Well, this particular radio puts in the eight horizontal lines and you fill in the digits one at a time.
Oh.
And they call those wiffle trees.
Okay, I wasn't even looking at the main display. I was looking at what's under it.
Oh, no, you're supposed to have been looking at the stuff in the display. I'll try that again.
Okay, I'll do right this time, maybe. Okay, wiffle trees.
So that's the deal with wiffle trees. Let me put my camera back here out of the way.
Well, we don't like wiffle trees?
Wiffle trees are cool, but and I wrote it up in the review because I thought that was unique, but that part of the review did not make the cut. So, oh well.
Okay.
Try to put my watch where I can see it here. We're burning through time here like crazy. as you might imagine, as we always do. So sadly, wiffle trees didn't make the cut. I'm going to ask him if I can take the full review, everything that I wrote, and put it on my website. I could rewrite it a little bit, and put it anywhere I want. I could sell it to CQ if I wanted to. If I wanted to rewrite it, I don't really want to rewrite it. I just want to take the big one and put it on my website. So I'll ask him if I can do that. You know, with the new digital QST, there's no reason things couldn't get lots longer. The main reason for not making things lots longer is because it takes time to edit and put things together and you know, build them all. Well, they've got this whole article. It won't only be a little bit longer to make something that could go on the web where space is relatively infinite.
Right. Well, there's still the printed copy, right?
Yeah, they make the printed copy, and the online digital copy is essentially an identical version of the printed copy.
Right.
And the only extra things...
Two editions of every publication would be tough to manage, it seems like.
I want it. Yeah. That's why they don't. And if they could make lots of extra stuff and do it for the web, they would. And maybe someday they will. But for now, they pretty much can't. Which is why I'm just going to say, hey, would it be okay if I make my own version and put it on my website for you, the Ham Radio Now fans? And you know, speaking of the Ham Radio Now fans, I want to take this moment to remind you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you and your conduit for bringing yourself Ham Radio Now is that guy back there, Arvin, our little mascot. So just stop by. Here's my website down here on the title, hamradionow.tv. Stop by there and click on Arvin, the little icon. You can go make a contribution.
Yeah, we like Arvin.
People complain that I'm, quote, always, I need the whole camera here. I'm always begging for money. I'm not always begging for money. Every show has a little beg, but I'm not always doing it. People whine a lot.
Okay, let's move on.
Oh, you want to get to the subject at hand?
No, that's just territory we've covered many times before.
Oh, but I guess you never listened to Rush Limbaugh.
No.
Yeah, well, I learned something from Rush. I've learned many things from Rush, but I've learned one thing in particular from Rush, and that is that you have to say the same thing over and over and over again. Have you ever heard that joke? Never, ever repeat redundancies over and over again.
No, but it's very redundant.
Yes, but Rush does that, and he does it for a reason. If you want people to understand what you're talking about, you got to tell them more than once.
Yeah.
You teach classes.
Yeah.
You must go over important concepts anyway, more than once.
Well, basically, I tell them what I'm about to tell them, and then I tell them.
And then you tell them what you told them.
Yeah.
But in a radio show or a television show, you pretty much cover the same content. And part of it is because not everybody's watching everything you put out all the way through all the time. So anyway, on to 60 meters. I'm going to condense our discussion part of it and then record some more because your time frame is limited. You've got to go out to dinner and stuff. And
yeah, and I'm 100 miles from here.
you got to get going. So I expect that I'm going to make this program probably long enough to be two episodes. I'll probably have to cut it in the middle.
Right when I was thinking I was going to watch one of your shows, you go and do this.
Sorry. So you won't have enough time to I don't have enough time with you to do it all while you're here. So I'll just stare into the camera all by myself, talking about what I got to talk about. I'm going to read my manifesto, but I'll wait to read the manifesto until I'm staring into the camera all by myself. I just read it to myself a few minutes ago. It takes 10 minutes. So
I probably will watch these programs because Bobby has 4 hours of oral surgery tomorrow afternoon. So I'll be taking the PC.
Okay. Yeah. You could even watch it on your phone.
Oh.
You probably want to download it.
Yeah, probably so.
And since it's difficult to download my programs, they're on iTunes. You could download it on iTunes, but it's not going to be on iTunes very much longer because my route to iTunes is through a service called blip.tv.
Right.
And I upload it to Blip, and they send it to iTunes. But they have notified me that I think it's the end of February they're going to stop doing iTunes.
Oh.
So that's sad. Oh. Yeah. I'll have to find another way to get to iTunes. I am a terrible podcaster. I'm a good content creator, but I'm really terrible at the website and the distribution and all that stuff. It goes on YouTube. It goes on Blip. Blip helps me get it to iTunes. I stick an audio version up on my own website, and sooner or later, the website folks are going to send me a notice and saying, you know, you're about 5,000% above our bandwidth content, bandwidth limits and download
limits. If only you had like some audience that could hear your plea and maybe make suggestions on how to better do that.
These people don't know anything. They're all dummies. I've asked. No one. In fact, somebody said, could you get a Roku channel? I'd like to be able to watch you on my Roku. I would love to have a Roku channel. It just takes time and learning how and going through the steps to get it on there. And I've said, if you want me on a Roku channel, tell me how. In simple caveman steps that a dummy like me can understand.
Well, you can research it yourself now that the Tapper stuff's done, right?
Right, yeah. If you don't want to see another program for 2 months, I'll be glad to research it myself and do all that stuff. So, I need...
Never pegged you as a slow learner.
I am. I have a learning disability.
Oh. Yeah,
it takes me a long time to learn stuff. It takes me a long time to get the motivation to want to learn something.
Right.
And then a real long time to actually get there. So let's talk about 60 meters just a little bit.
Okay.
Let me bring up my graphic. 60 meters, give or take. I've given you a good enough picture to see what's there.
I can see it, yeah.
5 megahertz on the left, 60 meters, precisely 5 megahertz. Do the math. You can do the math for me, right?
Yeah, right. Right.
I've lost your picture there. Okay, what's the math? What's the formula?
Well, it's 300 million divided by the frequency gives you the wavelength, okay. Or in this case, the wavelength to get the frequency.
Little simple algebra. Yeah. So so that's it. 60 meters, 5 megahertz right there on the left side. I'm going to get my cursor over here. Those are the channels that we've got now. These right here, the five little slivers, and this chart is only roughly to scale. The widths are not precisely exactly what they ought to be. Down here is an interesting frequency. That is, I marked it KL7 only, but it's not an amateur frequency. It's the Alaska emergency frequency. They get some special dispensation from the Vatican in Alaska on a single 5 megahertz frequency that I think anybody can use. I'm not sure what the regulations are, but hams can use it. Government uses it because, you know, it's our last Wild West territory. There's a lot of rugged terrain out there. Communications are not particularly available everywhere. So they get that little spot at 5167.5, and I believe that's upper sideband is what they get there. So so this is 60 meters, and again, our five discrete channels. So in the last episode of Ham Radio Now, I was talking to Brennan Price, the ARRL's man in Washington, about what's coming up. It's the World Radio Conference, WRC 15. It is a year from November. And it will be figuring out a lot of stuff about the radio spectrum. Not everything about the radio spectrum. There's no way they could get through it. But there's an agenda of things that governments have, that the private industry has, and there's a little thing that ham radio has. The agenda for WRC 15 was set back at WRC 12. That's where they do the agenda setting. Mm-hmm. And on the agenda was an amateur radio 60-meter band. So, again, we've got these five discrete frequencies. And we're not the only people that have them. There's an idea of what's going on 60 meters in the rest of the world. And
the UK and Cuba?
Well, okay. Well, I didn't mark everything. It would get a little bit too cluttered. Although, okay. For some reason, I also made it very small.
Okay, but there are other countries.
Yeah, hopefully people are watching in high def and they can see this this eye chart pretty well. I may zoom it in a little bit when I get done. Down here, this one little outlier is in Australia, VK. And then Cuba has an actual band. Almost everybody else is discrete individual frequencies, but Cuba has got a small band, and they just got it.
Is that 20 kilohertz?
I think it's about 20 kilohertz wide. Again, this is not totally to scale. Let me see if I can zoom in. Yeah, there we go. But as soon as I try to move it, it's going to jump. There we go. We're good. They get a little bit of a band. All these other little blue lines, they are other countries' individual discrete frequencies, kind of like what we've got, just a single channel for something. Except for the United Kingdom, where things are very, very different, and they have a bunch of little bands. Most of them
they're the green.
Yeah. Most of them are around 4 kilohertz wide. Some of them are up to 6 kilohertz wide. And you don't have to take your headset off to sneeze or whatever because you're on a separate channel. I can mute you out.
Oh, okay.
I can make you go away and edit you out.
The reason I'm here and you're there is because I'm sick.
That's right. I was gonna mention that. You're on Skype even though you're only a couple miles away because I'm keeping you at viral distance.
Yeah. It's not that you're germophobic. You just think proximity to germs has a lot to do with whether or not you get it.
Yeah, I was strange that way. So you caught a cold.
Yeah.
You were on a service trip. Where were you?
Yeah, I was outside of St. Louis, Missouri, the tiny town of Wright City, Missouri.
Did you get it while you were still out there working, or was it just on your way back?
Well, I don't know. I woke up Friday morning. Friday morning was my return day, and I felt fine when I woke up. My throat might have been a little drier than usual, but that's not, that's common in hotel rooms, so I thought nothing of it. And by the time I got to the airport, I had a bit of a sniffle. And by the time I got on the plane, I had a raging nose. And then an hour later, I had ear pain bad enough. I thought, oh, boy.
Yeah. Airplanes
I'm going to the minute clinic when we get home.
Well, I was feeling bad for you because I thought probably you were working on some equipment. Well, you were feeling terrible, but that turns out that was not the case.
No, I was done with it.
But as we discussed as you were coming back, I was talking to you on the phone. This was your first epic fail.
Well, it's not like a epic fail worthy of song and stuff, but it was the first time I ever came back not knowing whether or not I had solved the problem. And it's because what I was working on worked fine when I got there. It's a problem where it would work a couple of days and then act up for a few hours and work a couple of days, act up a few hours, and I could not make it act up. So I changed the parts that I thought was most likely to cost the problem, even though they tested just fine. So basically, I tested the parts. They tested fine, so I changed them anyway. And now I've just got to give it a couple of days and call them and see how it's behaving.
Yep.
They have been resetting things to make it work. And I did ask them, next time it fails, if they could stand the downtime to not reset it, just call me and I'll see if I can get straight to the airport.
So it's one of those deals where you can't fix it if it won't stay broke.
Right.
Yeah. And that happens a lot.
Yeah.
So I'll send a radio back to whoever the manufacturer is, because I don't fix my own stuff, and say, it's intermittent. Good luck. Sometimes it doesn't work. Sometimes it does. You know, put it on the shelf. Let it burn in for a while. Turn it on. Let it burn in for a while. All right. So it wasn't an epic fail, but I like that phrase.
You know, oh, I do too.
The kids use that phrase all the time. I'm learning.
Oh, I failed most egregiously.
Yeah. Okay. So back to 60 meters. So what has happened here is that at the WRC, the proposal is for a ham band. You know, there's no ham band at 60 meters.
We got all these
spectrum that hams are using allocated by their individual national governments, mm-hmm. but there's no ham band.
You mean internationally?
Internationally,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
And
right.
as you perhaps are aware, radio signals do not respect national borders. They don't respect any borders. You know, a police department would love it if their radio system went to the edge of the city
and stopped.
And stopped.
Right.
But it doesn't. You know. So so we have to have agreements that at least travel to the distance that the radio signals do. And right. on 5 megahertz, that's worldwide. So and just about everything is done worldwide one way or another. So the International Telecommunications Union is the international body. It's probably part of the United Nations. I'm not real good on that stuff. They're the ones that hold these world radio conferences every 3 or so years, and they hammer out whatever's they figure out they got to do at the next one. So one of the things that is on the agenda for this next one is an actual band at 60 meters.
So, great.
So once again, there's our 60. There's. Oh, I was telling you, the United Kingdom has these weird little things. That's why they're in green. All these little blue ones.
I can't see your graphics anymore. The video has gone away.
Did I go to black or just freeze?
It's just froze. Well, I mean, I see a still shot of you.
Okay. Hopefully,
in the middle.
Hopefully, we'll come back. But what people are looking at here are these little green blocks. They are the United Kingdom's spectrum, and they are in approximately 4 kilohertz, which I'm not sure what that's good for, because they don't operate from over there. Maybe I'll ask somebody sometime. A couple of them are 6 kilohertz wide, but they get that unusual broken up spectrum, you know, little bits and pieces all over the place.
Yeah.
So that's what the world has been dealing with, or what ham radio has been dealing with across the world for a long, long time. Now, before I talk about what's going to come up, I want to talk about why we're interested in 60 meters at all. What is the deal? And this is probably a good time to have you do some explaining, because you teach this stuff pretty well. Why do we even care about a 60-meter band?
Well, it can fill the niche between the longer wavelengths and the shorter wavelengths. It all has to do with the maximum usable frequency. When sunspot activity is low, you know, at the low part of the cycle, not like we are now, oftentimes 20 meters isn't as usable as it is in better times. So these lower frequency bands can promote long-range communications when otherwise that communication wouldn't be possible. So it's not real bad. It's good at night. You know, it's long enough that that it has some of the characteristics of 80 meters or 75 meters. Short enough, it shares some of the characteristics of 40 meters. So it's in the middle between 40 and 80.
And let's talk a little bit more about some of the characteristics of the band, daytime versus nighttime. Because as we were asking for it, we concentrated, we being the ARL and people who said we need this spectrum, we concentrated on daytime, not nighttime.
Yeah.
So what's its deal during the day? Well 80 meters we know during the day is gets punked out pretty bad.
Yeah, D-layer absorption. And you'll have that
Now don't just say that, because you've got to explain it a little bit. Some people have no clue about D-layer.
In one of your other videos, Wilbur made a good description of it. He said the D-layer just kind of sucks up the signal. One of the layers of the ionosphere, and it's the lowest layer, tends to absorb long wavelengths. shorter wavelengths bust right through, are refracted or bent by the upper layers and come back through pretty much unaffected again by the D layer. So at what's the cutoff frequency where the D layer stops absorbing long wave signals? How long does the wave have to be? Well, it depends on the ionization level. The more the ionization, it changes that. The higher the frequency will be that can still be absorbed. By the time you get up to 5 megahertz, it's not near as much of a problem. So at 5 megahertz, you're going to have daytime propagation. May not be real long, but that's desirable because then it permits for the reuse of frequencies.
Yeah, my experience with our lower frequency bands is that 80 meters is drastically affected by the D layer. I like the AM broadcast band. You know,
it
goes no place during the day. And 40 meters is significantly affected, but to a much less extent. 40 meters can be good to, and this is all highly variable, but 40 meters is good to 500 to closing 1,000 miles in the daytime. And of course, at night, it's a worldwide band.
Yeah, much longer at night, yeah. Right?
It's a worldwide band at night. 80 meters can be as short as 100 miles or so.
A county.
Yeah, yeah. Even less. And again, at night, it is a worldwide band. It's not easily a worldwide band, but worldwide DX is possible on 80 meters at night. And so what happens in the daytime is that 80 meters can get very short. So your signals can reach 100, 150 miles or so. 40 meters has a skip zone to maybe 300 miles. So you got some blank territory in between, in exactly the kind of regional need that daytime emergency communications on HF want to be able to fill. And the circumstances where you need that are the fairly drastic ones, where VHF, the repeaters, a network, a link system, is down mm-hmm. on a wide regional basis because something really bad happened.
Right.
And knocked down a lot of town.
Hurricane Andrew would be a perfect application for it.
Yeah, Katrina did a pretty good job of knocking stuff down. There were some repeaters that survived Katrina, but they were drastically overloaded, very few of them. And in rural territories, not much made it through all that. So those things can still happen. And if 80 meters is too short and 40 meters is too long, you're kind of stuck.
Yeah, 60 meters.
Yeah, 60 meters, right in the middle, and it's perfect. So that's what we asked for. But 60 meters wasn't a ham band. And 60 meters also wasn't under the auspices of, it wasn't a ham band internationally. And in the U.S., it was not under the auspices of the FCC. The FCC couldn't say what would be done in that area. It was under the auspices of the NTIA, the National Telecommunications Information Agency, I think is what that's called.
I had no idea.
And that is the FCC of the federal government. The military, aviation, stuff that is run by the federal government that needs communications, and that spectrum, the NTIA gets their slice of spectrum, the FCC gets their slice of spectrum, and the NTIA divvies out and, you know, sets up how all that stuff is going to be. And although the FCC operates fairly much in the daylight, the NTIA operates very much in the dark because a lot of their stuff is covert.
Right.
National security.
And they had control of 5 to 6 megahertz?
They had most of that spectrum, yeah. So the FCC went with our interests in mind, somewhat hat in hand, and said, can we get some spectrum down there? And with a lot of wheeling and dealing, the NTIA came up with these 5 channels that we have down on 60.
Right.
So that's been interesting. And now we've got some experience with it. It was in 2002 that we first got it. How much 60-meter operating have you done?
Precious little.
But you talked to me on 60, I believe, when I was driving out to Seattle.
Yeah, I had to modify my radio to do it, though.
Yep, and I was in Ohio, which is, and we were probably 300 miles apart or so, middle of the day. I was in southeastern Ohio, the same route that we take when we drive to Dayton.
Yeah, closer to 400, I think. Yeah.
And it worked good. We had good signals. So mm-hmm. It was a very nice band for what we were doing. We didn't try 40 meters and 80 meters, I don't think. No. 40 meters probably would have worked pretty well at that. 80 meters might have, that time of day, might have been a little bit too far. So I play with it mobile quite a bit. I play with it a little bit at home. And I enjoy it in the daytime. I don't play with it very much at night. At night, it's just another ham radio band with a lot of people trying to work DX. But I think most hams who think about 60 meters, their orientation is nighttime. You know, DX is our deal. So I hear more activity, and I hear almost no activity during the day. Some guys in the morning, there's some guys rag chewing on some of the channels in the morning.
Yeah. Well, you know, 75 meters, you hear nothing during the day and not very much on 40. Most people are probably on the higher bands.
Yeah, I actually do hear a fair amount of activity on 40. 40's got those regional mobile nets, mid cars, east cars.
Oh, yeah.
South cars. There's no west cars that I was able to determine in my trip out west. But there are some big nets out there. Gordon West runs a big net for a couple of hours every morning. That has net controls that are regional, and I slipped in and managed to make a contact with him. He didn't recognize me. He didn't recognize my call sign. It's very busy. They get dozens and dozens, maybe hundreds of people checking in. So, anyway, it was on the way back from Seattle that I did that. So we've had the experience with five channels on 60 meters, and this, in terms of ham radio, it's weird. I mean, to even call
it is,
them,
it is weird.
To even call them channels is unusual for hams on HF.
Right.
On VHF, when FM finally came around in the late 60s, we had to, quote, channelize.
Yep.
For a couple of reasons. One, the equipment that we were using was on FM was converted surplus equipment. It was crystal controlled transmit and receive. And let me make this point now, that ham radio is the only service that doesn't understand the concept of being channelized in terms of HF. When you talk about being channelized, hams will say, it's CB. CB is channelized. Except for us, everything is channelized. Except for us. Absolutely everything is channelized.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of advantages to being a ham radio operator. And not being bound by channels is one. Not being bound by type acceptance is another.
Yeah.
Hams are the only people in the world that can build a radio and put it on the air.
Yep, that is true. Both of those things are true. Yeah. So, so this 60-meter thing, we ended up with these channels.
Yeah.
And we thought that it was weird. We kind of didn't like it.
Yep.
And after I did the show with Brennan, I put a notice on QRZ.com that the show was there. And I'm not going to bring this up now, but I'll in post-production as I edit this, I will bring up that website, the QRZ.com, and a few others. So you're not going to see them, but the folks out there watching in the audience, they're going to see them. Normally, folks looking at my announcements on QRZ.com, they'll see somewhere between 500 and maybe 1,000 people, if it's a popular topic, will look at the announcement of the episode that I've got. And maybe every once in a while, somebody will make a comment. And the episodes themselves will be seen typically by 500 to 1,500 people,
right.
somewhere in there. At least right. Those are the numbers of people that start watching the episode. Far fewer make it all the way to the end. So this episode, I think it was 131, talking to Brennan, the QRZ page went nuts. At last count, well over 5,000 people had clicked on that announcement.
Right, okay.
Not nearly all of them.
So a big deal.
Yeah, not nearly all of them. And on QRZ.com, the average announcements gets kind of what I do. A few hundred to maybe a little over 1,000. Really super big announcements, things that really capture a lot of people's attention can go over 10,000, 15,000 or so. But 5,000 is still pretty big. Very few reach the 5,000 level. I don't know on QRZ.com whether it adds to that count every time someone clicks. If the same person looks at it 100 times, does that add 100? Or does that add just one? And do they recognize the IP address and say, well, no, we're not going to let you artificially boost up the view count just by click, 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 click. If they're smart, they do that. In any case, you can still see relatively what everybody looks like. And 5,000 is still big. And I didn't click on it hundreds of times myself. And you didn't. No one else was going to, just to make us look good. So this looked good on QRZ. The episode, not all those people who clicked on it looked at the episode. It's just skated over 1,000 views on the YouTube and you know, a few dozen more on Blip and stuff. So it's getting viewed pretty well, at least people starting it. But if you look at the what they call the audience retention, it falls off pretty quick because it's long. It's like 1 hour and 10 minutes. It's very wonky.
Audience retention is how the rate at which people drop off as they're watching it. Yeah.
Yeah, and YouTube provides a graph. I'll show the graph here. YouTube provides a graph that from beginning to the end, you can see the percentage of the audience from 100 at the beginning that is still watching, and this falls off quick and then hangs in low for a lot of the rest of the episode.
But most videos do that, don't they?
Most long ones do. But this one drops off particularly fast. Most of them, I see a graph that is kind of linear from the beginning to the end. It drops off from 100 to about 75% in the first few minutes, and then takes a linear taper down toward the end. It may kind of level off at about halfway, two-thirds of the way through, and then hang in there at 25-30% till the end.
Okay. That's all the people that went off to do something else and forgot it was playing.
Yeah, or just, because you wonder, you know, somebody's got 30 minutes invested in something. They must be interested enough. Why didn't they make it to the end? I don't know. But those are the graphs that I get to see. You can't see them on YouTube unless the channel owner decides to put them up. In fact, I can't even turn them on for everybody to see. I can only put them here and show you. So it got popular, but the other thing that got popular about it is that every once in a while somebody will make a comment or two on one of the announcements that I make. You know, they'll say, "This is a good show. I like that show." Sometimes they'll actually comment on the content. This has like 50 comments, so it is also relatively busy in terms of hams reacting to it. Not much is happening anymore. It's down. It's off the front page. It's down the list. You know, it's old news. So not much is happening anymore, but it got its serious share of attention. Something surprised me. People started talking about things that we were talking about in that episode, and in particular, some things that I mentioned in my post but didn't make a big deal of. And that is that I kind of like the idea that 60 meters is channelized. Mm. With the experience that I've had in the 10 years that I've been operating it casually on and off, I like the idea, and there's really only one thing that I think is a big advantage to this channelization thing. Only one big thing. I tried to think of a lot of things, but I can only really come up with one big one.
What is it?
No interference. No interference. Not no interference. Okay. No interference from stations that have slid up just a little below and a little bit above you.
Right.
So in this thing that we've got in ham radio where we can pick just about whatever frequency within our band and within our license privileges that we want to operate on, mm-hmm. What we do with that is we crowd each other.
Yeah.
And it's not necessarily because the bands are all that crowded. There was a day when the bands were real crowded. Not so much anymore. Even in this kind of Midland sunspot cycle peak, most of the bands are not super crowded. 80 meters, the phone band, and I am speaking from a sideband perspective for the most part. You can fill us in on the CW bands because I don't operate down there much. The phone bands are not all that crowded anymore. 80 meters used to get real crowded. Now the phone band on 80 is so wide, it's 400 kilohertz wide. Not for generals. I think they get 300 kilohertz, but there's still so much space that even at night when the band is open worldwide, you can find 10, 20 kilohertz wide swaths of spectrum toward the bottom that no one's operating in.
Right. So
it's not that crowded. But at the top, we're still all doing this with each other. And getting too close. I'm not talking about contests. I'm not talking about de-expeditions or DX pileups. I'm talking about just ordinary routine operation. So on 60 meters, that doesn't happen.
Yeah, and right now that we're getting to the meat of it, and I'm about to hear what you had to say, I'm out of time.
You got to go.
I got to go.
Well, do you have a what I'm proposing is that we channelize all of this new spectrum on 60 meters. This is not going
to
be popular.
6 megahertz?
Well, we're not going to get all that. The proposal is currently 175 kilohertz worth. And let me go back to the chart. I'll show you that.
Yeah, I can't see it, though. What 175 kilohertz
much
is
at all. It is from 5275 to 5450. Okay. It encompasses all of the five channels that we've got with a little elbow room on both sides and most of what everybody else is using. It's okay, for the folks watching the video, that's that blue bar kind of in the background on it.
So the second harmonic is nowhere near 30 meters, so we don't get the advantage that the ham bands were originally, you know, structured the way they are to gain.
Yeah.
But then people don't build their own equipment that much anymore.
Not for 60 meters.
Anyway. Yeah, and you think the whole thing should be channelized?
I think that the whole thing should be channelized for that one particular reason.
Interference?
And it's not something that we have ever proven ourselves to be capable of doing voluntarily, and it may not be something that we even care about. I care about it. And as it turns out, what I was getting at with this stuff on QRZ, a lot of other people did too. A lot of folks said they like this channelized thing because they like their freedom from adjacent frequency interference from hams that slide up too close to each other. There would be 58 channels down there if we get the whole 175 kilohertz.
Yeah.
And various ways to put it together. So before you take off, let me get your feeling about that, and then I'll go just talk to the camera here for some.
I don't like the idea of a channelized 60 meter band.
Yeah, you would prefer to stay the way we are.
On five channels.
Well, assuming that we get 100 kilohertz to 175 kilohertz,
and I'll tell you why. If we want it to be a worldwide ham band, there has to be agreement on how it is to work. And I think agreement on a channelized ham band would be practically impossible to get. So that's a serious impediment to the 60-meter band gaining any traction at all at WRC. So that's a big strike against that. Now, as far as interference, you know, hams have 100 years of experience of dealing with that, and it's just not that big a problem. If people really want to be channelized and no adjacent frequency interference and all, you know, go to 2 meters. The 6 meter band. Let the smart operators operate the 60 meter band. They've been operating HF that way for 100 years, with no problems. If you channelize it, you reduce the number of people that can use a frequency, because there will be modes that don't take anywhere near whatever the channel width is, unless they channelize it with narrow channels for digital and wider channels for the various phone modes and so forth. And then we end up with, you know, a convoluted mess. And we have the more the ham bands are similar from one to another, the better it's going to be for hams. If it's channelized, how many channels are going to be dedicated to this purpose or that purpose, weather reporting or APRS type services, this sort of thing, you know? Bad idea. VFO. We want VFOs on 60 meters.
All right. Well, that's what I was looking for. Yeah. And I appreciate your perspective on that.
Who's with me?
I wish I was going to be able to give you the opportunity to counter all of my counter arguments that I will now make, because I am going to lay you out.
Yeah, sure. Carry on. But and I hate to just give my opinion and run. I really do.
Yeah, because you'd like to be able to counter my counter arguments, and you won't have a chance.
Yeah.
But I have anticipated every one of the things that you said. I've got I've got it in writing. It's all been published. Prior to your speaking, you haven't had a chance to look at it. But I'm not just saying it. So now I will go through it and make myself exceedingly unpopular with a large percentage of not only my audience, but the entire amateur radio community. And I will now admit, while you're still on here, I will now admit that although I would like to actually see this, I would like this to be the way things are. And I will make my comments to the FCC. I got till February 18th. I will make these my comments to the FCC. I'm going to refine them a little bit from what I've published already. Mm-hmm. I've thought of some different things. But a big part of why I'm doing this is because that's what we do here on television. We get a little bit radical, and we gather an audience.
Yeah, you want to be the hard-hitting reporter. No. So is the popular view VFO and channelized is the unpopular view?
On the 60-meter comments, it was maybe like 60-40 more people being traditional. But a surprising number of folks coming on and saying, I think I kind of like this channelized thing.
Okay. Well, give me a reason to like it, and interference ain't going to be it because I just don't see it as a big problem.
Well, I will talk more about what interference does and doesn't do for us. No, it doesn't do anything for us, but it does cause some problems in some aspects, more than just inconvenience or undesirability.
Well, yeah, right. And I'm not talking about emergency communications, which is like less than 1%
of but you have to.
The band is used for. Well,
but you do have to.
Okay.
Because yes, it is rare, but when it happens, it needs to be good. And so the question is, then, can we do something that would accommodate all the interests and still keep people far enough apart that they're not elbowing each other constantly? And I think we can.
All right. I look forward to seeing it.
Go have a good dinner.
Bye, everybody. Nice to see you.
This is going to be a little Skype hang-up. Let me put your full screen, and we will hear the blip. Here we go. Bye-bye. All right. This looks like a good point to take a break. And I make these programs into two separate pieces because I don't want to go past an hour. There's too much video compression to make an episode much longer than an hour. I don't like to do that. So let me take a break and come back, and I will review my proposal and my reasons for doing it. And this won't necessarily be the end of it. I've got other shows lined up to do, plenty of other things to do here on Ham Radio Now, but this is an issue that is not necessarily going to go away or go away quickly because there's other people interested in it. So I'll pay a little bit more attention to it in the fairly near future. February 18th, 2014 is the last time that we can comment on the FCC's version of the United States position of the proposal to be made at the World Radio Conference. Other countries coming up with their own proposals. Eventually we'll hammer something out and maybe we'll get a 60-meter band out of it. So we will see. So let me wrap up this episode of Ham Radio Now and come back with a part two in whenever you want to push the go button, if you ever do. So it'll be the same episode, but we'll be part two in just a minute. But for now, once again with Arvin watching things in the background, asking you to stop by hamradionow.tv and contribute to this. And if you really don't like the idea of 60-meter channels, contribute more. Show me. Show me what guts you've got. Over and out.